Hello. This is the first one of a series of lectures, presentations of the new metropolitan discipline that we have to develop. Metropolises are growing very fast all over the world and sometimes doubling in size every 14 years. And we don't still have mechanisms to control and to develop those metropolises. And we have to develop that because this is a new phenomenon. This is taking place in the last 60, 70 years, and we really must develop the discipline to know how to deal with that. And this series of lectures is exactly the beginning, the inception of that new discipline that we are going to share, and we will see the way forward to it. Population around the world are moving very fast from rural to urban. As a matter of fact, 300,000 people every day are moving from the rural areas, from the countryside to the cities. That means 50,000 in India, 30,000 in China. 300,000 people every day means building a metropolis of 2 million people every week. And we don't know how to do it. We do not have the tools for that. And this has been going on for 60 years, and it's going to go on for the next 50 years, probably. And in that time, something like 2 billion people are going to move to cities, and it is really a must to create that discipline, to be able to handle it. In the history of the world, there has only been three cities that were larger than 700,000 inhabitants. That was Rome of Julius Caesar, that was Beijing of the Ming Dynasty, and that was London of Queen Victoria, from 600,000 to 1 million. Now we have 600. We have 600 cities where we had previously only three. And that is a completely new setting that we have to deal and we have to know how to manage. When you're growing by 5% every year, and many of the metropolises around the world, the developing metropolises, are growing at that pace, 5% every year, that means that you double every 14 years. So if it took you 2,000 years to come to the situation you are now, for instance, London was founded by the Romans, and it has taken 2,000 years to come to the actual situation. Imagine if you have to double the size of London in 14 years. That will be an explosion, an enormous explosion, and requires new ways of doing that kind of thing. If it was New York, it is not New York, but if it was New York, if it were New York, that will mean 10 blocks every day. So that will mean going down an avenue in New York and with a fairy stick touching the ground and seeing how that block built in 1 hour. 10 blocks every day is one block every 2 hours. So the challenge is immense, and we don't know how to deal with that. So that's what we are building, the way to build. That has a limit. The world is growing in population. We are 7 billion now, 7 point something billion, but we will grow up to 11 billion. When we will reach 11 billion, the world will stabilize, because the economy, the culture, the development means that the families are smaller, and you don't have as many children as in rural settings. So moving to urban is changing the pattern of demography of the world, and we will reach. But even reaching that level of 11 billion people, 75% of the population is going to be urban. In developed countries, 70, 75, 80% of the population is urban, and that is going to be the future situation of the world. So we must produce cities that will be able to house this kind of population, which is really doubling the number of people now living in cities. And as we are not able to do that, what we are producing is this. We are producing a world of slums that is going to be our inheritance to the next generation. And that is terrible, because to upgrade a slum, to make it really into a city, the cost of it is from 3 to 7 times more expensive than doing it right from the beginning. So we must do it right from the beginning. Metropolises are extremely powerful. That's why they are growing. People go to the metropolises because they have the hope to improve their situation. And they are extremely powerful. There are metropolises which are as powerful as countries in the world. I can give you the example of Los Angeles, San Diego is like Spain. Madrid is like Colombia. Paris is three times Peru, and those metropolis, Argentina is like Dallas, those metropolis have the need to be managed in another way, different from the cities are, no? The five most important metropolises of USA are 25% of the GDP of the USA, and the USA is the 25% of the GDP of the world. So five metropolises in the USA are equivalent to 12.5% of the GDP of the world. That is the power of metropolis in economic terms. And to prove that metropolis are much more efficient than rural or small cities is the effect of economies of scale. And to prove that, we have figures all over the world, but let me just mention China, where you see that with the average GDP of China is $8,000 per capita, in the metropolises that are beyond 10 million inhabitants, you can reach $40,000 and $45,000 per capita. We will see that in the future lectures along here. Metropolises are efficient because of a very simple principle of economies of scale. The larger you are, the more efficient you are. That works in biology, no? The larger an animal is, the more efficient he is in the consumption of energy. If we are looking at this slide that refers the size of the animals and their consumption of energy, if it were proportionate to the size of the animal, the slope of the line will be 45%, will be 1-to-1, no, will be a slope. As the slope is smaller than that 45% slope, that means that you are more efficient as you grow larger. You are more efficient. And that happens with metropolis, and that's why metropolis are growing. We can see that, for instance, in the number of petrol stations needed in a city or in a large city or in a metropolis. The larger you grow, the less you need those petrol stations, because the same petrol station can serve much, much more people. So if you need less petrol station, you can use the resources of those extra petrol stations to invest in something else and to make you more productive. So it's a chain of efficiency that grows up. And that works in petrol stations, for example, in four countries, France, Germany, and Netherlands, and Spain. But it works as well for many other aspects, as GDP, income, creativity, crime, all the aspects of a metropolis are increased, are multiplied, the efficiency, the effect of the size. So metropolis are attracting people because they are more efficient and they offer a future of hope for those who come. Even if they don't find hope for themselves, they always have the hope of their children will improve, no? And the rule of that efficiency, as Geoffrey West points out, is that when you double the size of a metropolis, you increase by 15% of the efficiency. But not only the metropolis are doubling the size, but if you achieve to get a good transport system in a metropolis that really provides more accessibility to the double of population, even if you have not doubled in size, provides accessibility to the double of population, you immediately are increasing the efficiency of that metropolis, multiplying it by 15%. That is why the investments in the metropolis are extremely efficient. We are dealing with a different scale of management. We have different disciplines that deal with different scales. Architects realize very well that when they design a house, they work at a 150 scale. When you design a street, a square, a set of streets or square public spaces, you deal at 1,500. When you are dealing with an urban situation, you're dealing with 1,500. When you are dealing with a metropolis, 150,000. When you are dealing with a country, 1,500,000. When you are dealing with a continent, 1,500,000. And with the world, 50,000,000. And every one of those scales requires a different set of disciplines, a different set of knowledges to deal with it. You don't deal with an urban design space as you deal with an architecture building. You don't deal with city planning as you deal with urban design, etc., etc. And the metropolitan discipline is in between the urban discipline and the national planning discipline. And as you are dealing with installations, structures, light, surfaces in architecture, and then going on into engineering and civic engineering and sociology and economy and so on, you grow, and the discipline of metropolitan planning requires a different approach. These are some of the disciplines we are going to deal with along these lectures. And as you can see, economics, sociology, environment, law, etc., etc., and they are not the only ones. We will deal with more of them. And those are disciplines which are beyond urban design, urban planning, and not exactly the same as national decision making and national planning. To see the power of those metropolises, we can put them, their GDP, them among the nations of the world. And then you will see that the 14th nation, or the 14th territorial unit in economic power, is Tokyo, with as much output as Australia, or more than Mexico. New York will be the 15th, Los Angeles the 20th, etc., etc. Out of the 100 most important territorial units in the world in terms of economic output, 48 are metropolises. So metropolises are much more like countries in the way, on their economic weight, on the sociology mechanisms, and so metropolises are much more to be identified as countries in the way you manage them than as cities. And that is the result. In the future, we will probably will have to introduce the concept of the metropolis without the United Nations, because they will be the powerful elements in the future of setting up the equilibriums of the world. We have two ways of dealing with metropolis. We have the discipline of theory, which is the perfect theory approach that Leonardo set up, and the disciplines of practice, which are those which are empirical, that come out of the understanding of the real world and dealing with them. Metropolitan management, metropolitan planning, metropolitan discipline is a discipline of practice. And I brought to you as a final slide this image from Raphael, the Academy of Athens, where you see Plato and Aristoteles. Plato pointing to the sky, saying, we have to be discipline of theory, we have to be perfect. And Aristotle saying, no, we have to have our feet on the ground and we have to understand how the world works to be able to manage it. The discipline of metropolises is a discipline of practice, and so we will be closer to Aristotle than to Plato. Thank you very much. The next presentation is going to be about the metropolitan genoma. We are going to learn how we will deal with the elements that articulate the metropolis. And you can download these presentations from the webpage, which is right now in your screen. Thank you very much.